Hi everyone, I hope you are doing well. My name is Mizuki Takahashi. I am an associate professor at Bucknell University. So today I want to talk about our research on Japanese giant salamanders. And as you can see, the size of the salamander that I'm holding in the picture, these guys are really large animals. And as you can imagine, they live in large rivers usually. However, we know that sometimes they use small streams like this one, but we didn't know how often, commonly, and how they use these small streams. So 2 years ago, in 2018, I decided to take three of my research students to Japan and wanted to study how these giant salamanders use small streams like this one, which was conducted in Hyogo Prefecture in Japan. So like I said, three students that I took from Bucknell were Melissa, who is this girl, and Emma and Brianna. And this is how we conducted our research in Japan. Instead of physically finding salamanders, we decided to take water samples and try to investigate DNA of Japanese giant salamanders eluted into the stream water, because surprisingly they hide very well, so we can't really find them that easily. And also, my students were not that experienced to find those guys. And also, they are nocturnal. So if we wanted to find them, we had to conduct nighttime survey, which can be really difficult. So once again, we took water samples and then we brought them to the little kitchen of the field house, we called. And then we did filtration. And we did DNA extraction, and then we took the extracted DNA back to our lab at Bucknell University and conducted a quantitative PCR to detect presence, absence, and also estimate the concentrations of the Japanese giant salamander environmental DNA, we call it. So here's the results. We surveyed three streams, stream A, B, and C. And if you see these numbers on x-axis, this is the distance from the main stem. And then y-axis shows eDNA concentration. Nothing really difficult. You know, if you see red circles, that means these sites did not contain any eDNA, or we did not detect environmental DNA of Japanese giant salamanders, which means we detected eDNA of Japanese giant salamanders from most sites, which was really exciting because we did not see any salamanders when we did water sampling in the field. Especially, you notice there are two peaks along stream C here, the first one and second one, and I wanted to show you the photo images of the sites where we detected high concentrations of eDNA. So here's the first one. You can see the pile of mossy rocks. When we went to the site, we thought this might be a really good habitat for small juveniles and larval Japanese giant salamanders. So we spent about 30 minutes, an hour searching for these guys, and we found a juvenile. The size was about 40 centimeters, a little less than 40 centimeters. And then we found another individual, which was larval Japanese giant salamander, really, really cute animal. Finding these two small giant salamanders was really exciting because it's even more difficult to find small individuals than large individuals. So this was a really good finding. And here's the next peak. And this is the image of the site where we detected high concentration of eDNA. And we didn't know what was going on here, so we spent some time and we actually found a nesting site here, which, you know, you can really see that nesting site was there. And we found developing embryos coming out of the nesting site, which made us really happy. And then also we found a large male salamander called Denmaster guarding the nesting site and also eggs. And this was the largest individual we found during the survey. And as you can see, this male is really skinny. And we are thinking this male has been doing Denmaster for a couple of years and he probably didn't have time to forage. Therefore, he lost a body mass and couldn't really sustain his body mass and energy. But anyway, so based on our eDNA survey results, we conducted a careful daytime and nighttime survey for each strain, and we found a total of 23 salamanders. And as you can see, the body size of these guys, they are smaller for being giant salamanders. And we think there might be some separation of habitat between smaller individuals and larger individuals that live in larger section of the rivers. Therefore, small streams might be very important for small individuals to hide and grow large and then move to the large section of the streams. And also they might be breeding in small streams. Therefore, small streams might also provide habitats for nesting sites and small larvae and individual at the juvenile development. So that's the end of the presentation. I hope you enjoyed the short presentation. And I want you to think about at least two questions based on my presentation. The first one is, how can we use this eDNA technique, which is detecting DNA of the target species left in the environment to promote wildlife conservation? Second one, I really didn't get to talk about this, but these giant salamanders exhibit really interesting parental care behaviors. So if you look into internet and you might be able to find some interesting information about the parental care behaviors of these guys. Finally, I conduct research with Hanzaki Research Institute of Japan. So if you really want to see these guys in the wild, you can save up some money and plan the trip to Japan and visit the institute. And if I are there, I would be really happy to take you guys out to the field. And if I'm not there because of my teaching and all the other things, there are other members of the institute, and I'm sure they would be really happy to take you out to the field. That's it. I hope you enjoy the presentation. Thank you.